CNN reports since 2008, at least 43 states have cut higher education budgets. Joining me to talk about all of this, University Regents Chairman James Dean Levitt. Welcome back to the program, sir.
Thank you, John.
So is this just a scare tactic by Neil Smotrich just to send a message up to the legislature and the governor? Listen, you do this, we're going to declare bankruptcy. I mean, come on. Is he just trying to scare people or is it real?
Well, first of all, it's as real as it's going to get. And, you know, we've got $160 million. I mean, forget cuts, forget the percentages that sometimes get misleading, sometimes get misconstrued, sometimes get used by politicians, frankly, to advance their cause. But let's just look. Come
okay.
on. $160 million. I mean, how are you going to cut that out of eight institutions of higher education? One of the things that people don't recognize is that our faculty bylaws require us that in certain circumstances, if it looks like exigency is a real possibility, that we've got to go through our UNLV bylaws. And each of our institutions have similar bylaws. But in essence, what that means is that means a convening of the Faculty Senate Committee, the Fiscal Affairs Committee. And because in essence, when you're talking about exigency in the context of a university system, what you're doing in essence is having the ability, if absolutely necessary, to ignore some of the valuable rights and contracts that exist between employees and staff.
Let me cut to the chase. What this would allow the president to do is essentially fire professors without regards to any contracts they might have signed when they got there. That's why he would have to do this, because of these incredibly high salaried professors you guys have. Is that correct?
Regardless of the salary, you're absolutely correct. It allows us to do something that we're currently prohibited by doing because we have legal contracts in place, and certainly if we're not careful about the development of exigency and in terms of how this gets created, we're going to subject ourselves to legal challenges. So again, as I was quoted in the paper today, it's an absolute last resort, but people have to be on notice that after you've had three successive cuts in a row and when you have $160 million left, forget percentages. That's real money. Those are real dollars.
Why put people on notice in February? The legislative session's just started. It's only 6 or 7 days underway.
You know what? I think we probably should have put people on notice earlier than this, to be candid with you. I mean, how long does it take to preach the gospel? I mean, my goodness, you can't wait till the last week. And this comes back to the Democrats and their plan, their lack of plan. I mean, my God. I mean, this is real what we're talking about. We're going to need to be on your program each and every day, frankly, to have a chance at changing public sentiment. We should be.
You think you're that good that you should be on this program every day?
I think you need more people in higher education on here, frankly. And I think one of your segments should be devoted to it.
As you well know, I talk about this a lot. You know who else is talking about it, though? A conservative think tank, Nevada Policy Research Institute. They think guys like you and Neil Smotrich and the rest are just poor mouthing, and you claim this devastation. But here's what NPRI says. The operating budgets show that despite reductions in state subsidies and overblown rhetorical claims of the supposedly resulting devastation in 2008 and 2009, the Nevada System of Higher Education's operating budget in fiscal year 2010, $1.724 billion was actually $30 million larger than its fiscal year 2009 operating budget of $1.694 billion. Let me read you from another finding, Mr. Chairman. The data also shows that Nevada's subsidy to higher education more than doubled from fiscal year 2000 to fiscal year 2009, from $306 million to $623 million. After adjusting for inflation, Nevada's subsidy to higher education increased from $380 million in 2009 dollars in FY 2000 to $623 million in FY 2009. Listen, I happen to be offended by the use of the word subsidy there, because it's a state institution. It's supposed to be funding it. It's not really a subsidy. But those numbers are right, aren't they?
I didn't even hear subsidy. I thought you said investment.
Yeah, okay. All right, you know what I mean. I think they're using that. It's a highly charged word, but their math is right, is it not?
Well, their math's right, but again, I'm going to use the word investment, because that's what I thought I heard you say two times. maybe it's something I just imagined, but in any event, this just goes back to the heart of this debate. I mean, my God, are we taking the position that in 2000 that we were adequately funded? I mean, you look at our formula funding, 85% of the WICHE, the state, the regional average. I mean, my God, how about leading the state? How about leading the country in something? I mean, you look at Nevada, you look at the history, you look at the culture here. I mean, we're absolutely at war, and frankly, I believe it's a war culture. I believe it's a war that can be won. But we're going to need a lot of help from everybody, including this program. I mean, we need to be on here talking about this. These are real cuts.
I've never heard anybody come on here in just the first segment. I want to keep coming back on face to face, but I appreciate that. The provost at UNR really described this pretty well, I thought, Mark Johnson. He explained that by cutting 23 programs, sharply reducing six others, he insulated the rest of the school. This is the cuts that have already been made. Are we narrower? Yes, he said. But by cutting some areas strategically, we're able to maintain the current quality and size of other programs. And Neil Smatrisk, I've heard him say, the president of UNLV, we're going to have to become a smaller, selective institution. This is going to fundamentally change the nature of all the institutions in Nevada. And you have to make these terrible choices between access and quality, do you not?
Well, you have to make the choices, and I think at the end of the day, I've used the word before, cataclysmic. And, you know, I don't think there's a word strong enough to describe what's going to happen if the budget unfolds the way that it's been proposed by the current governor. I mean, there's got to be a revenue package, and to not be talking about it, I think, is criminal.
Well, there are people talking about it, just not publicly, right? And you seem to be equally upset with the Democrats for not presenting some kind of revenue plan.
Well, you know
what,
I think so. I mean, tell the story. I mean, my God, you can't do this in closed doors. You can't get the public sentiment. I mean, you can't even get business leaders on board right now. I mean, there's talks, there's discussions, but my God, I don't think you can have these outside of the light of the day. It all goes back to transparency. It all goes back to telling the story. And you just can't expect in the last week or two of the session to get the kind of support and sympathy. I mean, there's a lot of people out there suffering right now. There's a lot of unemployment. I mean, it doesn't matter which sector you look at. I mean, people are hurting. But again, this goes back to the type of tax system we have here where it's not broad-based, and when you have an economy that's dependent and reliant on a couple of industries, this is exactly where you see yourself. So why don't we do something different this time? Why aren't we thoughtful? Why don't we have the conversation about who we are, what we want to be when we grow up as a state?
Why don't we have this conversation on Face-to-Face in the next segment? What do you say?
How about that?
All right.